subject will be, can we grasp some lessons from the pandemic with this question, does future belongs to thriving agriculture? With this recent COVID and pandemic, a huge question appeared around the world on food availability, especially in the less favorized areas in the world. In India, you said that there was no scarcity, but at least you felt that there were very strong food insecurity that led to this massive reverse migration. And I must say, frankly, we have not been much informed here in the West. So you would talk about having those million of people traveling back to their native lands to ensure food security. So you will talk about this very, very painful situation and difficult situation. And this situation whole would bring the question of the relevance of our economical policies that pushed year after year all people from rural areas to cities. And by the end, we may answer the question, could this situation be a huge opportunity to make agriculture the pivot of future economical development? So those are the key questions we'll go through, and with three different views. Can we convert this food insecurity into security in food for our future generations? Can we check such mass migration or reverse migration? And let's talk also about all migrants around the world. We have not been talking much during this pandemic. And can we develop some new, maybe sustainable social economic model to work out this question for future? So those are the key issues we would like to...
80s, when Ronald Reagan was the US president, his agricultural secretary had made a statement, which is a very infamous statement. He said to farmers, get big or get out. Now that was in the mid 80s. And more recently, we have seen the International Food Policy Research Institute almost saying in this the same thing in almost the same language that you need to get out of agriculture if you are a small farmer. And this is the time for commercialization of agriculture. Now, this is something which has been brewing up over the decades. In fact, I would like to share an incident which I think would be very important for all of us to understand how the economic policies were designed to push farmers out of agriculture into the urban areas. Now, I recall that in 1996, it was about 25 years back, when a conference at the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation in Chennai, the then Vice President of Sustainable Development of the World Bank, Dr. Ismail Saragaldin, had made a statement in his presentation. He had said that the World Bank estimates the number of people who will be migrating from the rural to the urban areas in India in the next 20 years, which means by the year 2015, would be equal to twice the combined population of UK, France, and Germany. So the World Bank was estimating in 1996 that double the population of these three countries would be migrating from the rural to the urban areas in India in another 20 years, which means by the year 2015. Now, which means the combined population of these three countries is 200 million, even then and now. And the World Bank estimate was that 400 million people will migrate from rural to the urban areas in India. And this is not only true for India, this was something which was applicable to Africa, applicable to countries like Bangladesh, developing countries, and of course other countries also. The point I'm trying to make is, this was an economic design which was pushing people out of agriculture into the urban areas. And how do you push people out of agriculture is to create conditions, uneconomical conditions, as a result of which farmer is left with no choice but to abandon his farming and move into the cities. Now, the kind of reverse migration that we have seen in India, reverse migration we saw in Bangladesh, Pakistan, or the other developing countries, and even in the rich countries, it is quite evident that these were the people who were pushed out of agriculture. They came to the urban areas looking for better jobs or better livelihood. And eventually, when the lockdown happened, they were forced to quit because they realized that there was nothing for them for more than 2 days. And so they moved looking for a permanent food security base, which is their village. So we see in India hundreds of people, millions of people walking for hundreds of kilometers over the days to go back to their villages when the lockdown was imposed. Now, this clearly raises the point, you know, if in India alone 30 million people have gone back to the villages, this is just one of the estimates, and there are various other estimates floating around, and we just heard Farida telling us that millions of people also went back from Dhaka to the countryside. Now, this is what has happened globally, but these were the people who were actually pushed out of agriculture over the last few decades to come into the urban areas, because that's what economic growth model is all about. We must understand that the economic design that we have, or the GDP kind of a model of economic growth that the world follows, or call it neoliberal model of economic growth and so on and so forth. You know, we have been pushing people out of agriculture into the urban areas because economic policies were so designed that unless you sacrifice agriculture, you will not be having economic reforms, or the economic reforms will not remain viable. This is what was happening all over the decades. And the story I told you of the World Bank and the Indian situation clearly depicts that for several years, I must acknowledge that I thought that it was a warning for us. It was an alert. They were telling us that, you know, this is going to be happening, so you better take precautions. But no, this was a directive which our successive governments have been successively following over the last few decades. So pushing these people out of agriculture into the urban areas, this happened in Europe first, this happened in America, this happened in Latin America, it happened in Africa, it is happening in Asia over the last few decades, and we thought it was economic growth. But now I think we have realized, when I remember, before I say that, I recall that when I used to call these people, the 400 million people quitting agriculture and going to the urban areas, I used to call them agriculture refugees. But people couldn't understand, people couldn't place a picture of these agriculture refugees because they haven't seen them migrating the way they have seen them now. So now we see that people now understand, they can at least visualize what I mean by agriculture refugees, because they have seen millions of people walking home on foot, their blisters and their feet, carrying their children on their shoulders and so on and so forth, all these days. And that clearly tells us that how severe the crisis that we witness today is actually the outcome of economic policies that we have been laying out all over in the last few decades that the world has followed. Now, I think we have come to a situation today that COVID-19, for whatever reasons, has given us an opportunity to rethink our economic design. Why do we need to push people out of agriculture? I know many of us would say because economic growth happens only when we push people out of rural areas into the urban areas, because that is what you and me have been taught in our economic courses. If you recall your economic 101 course, economics 102 course, this is what we were taught, that the way to develop for the world is to push people out of rural areas into the urban areas, and because the urban areas need cheaper labor. Basically, to keep the economic reforms viable, two things were required. One was cheaper food, and the other one was cheaper labor. So for both these activities to be taken care of, the sacrificial goat was agriculture, because that's where you could draw cheaper labor into the cities, and that is where you also could keep subsistence level of farming, so that, you know, you could provide cheaper food all across. And this is what has happened. While food is cheap, available everywhere in the world, we haven't seen what happens to those millions of people who produce that cheaper food. Over the years, the people who have been producing cheaper food have been sacrificing their life, have been committing suicide, have been faced with a terrible, terrible agrarian distress. The distress is not only prevalent in India or in Bangladesh or in Nigeria or Senegal. It is also prevalent in France. It is prevalent in European Union. It is prevalent in America. And we have reached such a situation now that I see, when I remember a few years back, I've been traveling in Europe, and I realized when I asked some farmers there, that do the younger boys get married, the ones who are in agriculture? I was told, no. Even the younger boys who are on the farm in Europe are not getting married now. It's the same situation here in Punjab, where I live. It's the same situation in South India. The younger people in rural areas are not, because that's the social a fallout of the economic design that we created. So all over the world, we realize that the boys are not getting married, which is an indication that things are not going suitable for the rural areas anyway. Now, COVID-19 provides us, as I said, an opportunity to rethink. Can we not make agriculture economically viable, sustainable, and also profitable? Why do we need to push these people out from the villages into the cities? Why can't we actually reverse the reverse migration that we saw? We don't want these fellows to come back again and then go back again, and this kind of pendulum operating, or you know, year after year or decades after decade. I think the opportunity now for us, the world, is to rethink the development paradigm, to rethink the development model, make agriculture economically viable and profitable. I think anyone would appreciate that a country like Norway is importing 60% of its food. I think it should be growing 100% of its food, which needs, you need more people to go back to agriculture. We need to create an enabling environment for people to go back to agriculture. We need to provide more income into the hands of farmers so that they can become economically viable, because we have deliberately kept the income low. I have always been saying that if you look at the problem of agriculture, the problem that we don't want to see is that agriculture has been deliberately kept impoverished all over the years. When a farmer undertakes cultivation of crops, what he does not realize is that he is actually cultivating losses. And because the prices are kept deliberately low. And this is the situation prevalent all over. In Europe, farmers would not be able to survive if they were not getting artificial support by way of subsidies that Europe or America are farming. I think we should move away from intensive farming to non-chemical agriculture, to more sustainable, and as Helge said earlier, towards food sovereignty. And once that happens, we will also be able to take care of much of the problem that we face today, is climate change, and the related problems, I think, would also be addressed. So agriculture not only takes care of the economic viability of the populations, or the kind of population that all over the world are in serious crisis. We need to really provide, when we say hand-holding, this is the best opportunity of making agriculture economically viable. And secondly, agriculture is also the solution for problems that the world faces, like temperature rise and climate change, and also the destruction of soil, water, air, and oceans. I think, so here lies the solution. If agriculture could be reformed in that sense, when I say reformed, I don't mean to say privatized. I mean to say more power into the hands of farmers, small farmers, all over the world. And that's a time for reinvigorating agriculture. That's a time for revitalizing agriculture. Here is a time for bringing agriculture at the center stage of development now. So can we do it all across the world? The answer perhaps is yes. And I think we all need to put our head together and maybe use the rest of the time that we have got to think about it, how we can perhaps bring agriculture into the center of the development activity all over the world. The focus has to shift from the corporate to the masses, and masses are, of course, in agriculture and allied industry in the rural areas. So that's the kind of future that the COVID-19 has thrown before us, or has given us an opportunity. And I think in this short time, this should be an ideal opportunity for us to put our heads and grapple on this particular issue. Thank you, Ivan.
So we have knowledge in the communities, technologies in the communities, the best food in the technologies, farmers who are ready to work. They just need the system to support them. And that is the political system, the economic system that listens to farmers in rural areas, not imported extreme technologies that destroys everything that we built over the years.